My name is Marcus Hammarstedt. I'm originally from Sweden. Been in the game industry for a bit over 14 years. And yeah, I started out working at was it my f the first company I was at where I was employed, not only internship, was Massive Entertainment. I worked on a World in Conflict expansion, if anyone remembers that game. And after that, I worked at a bunch of companies, but it was at companies like Grin, and did an awful game based on the Terminator universe. And I've also worked in Poland on games on a game called Bulletstorm. And then I went back to Sweden, and I worked at Starbreeze and Machine Games. Worked on Brothers, and I worked on the Wolfenstein games. And after a bunch of years in Sweden, it was time to get a move on again. So then I spent a couple years at BioWare working on Anthem, which wasn't either a very successful game.
It looked
And
cool.
yeah, it was a good experience. It was fun,
Sure.
and met a lot of great people. And yeah, now I'm in Southern California.
Gotcha. So how many years have you been in the industry then?
About 14 years, yeah, a little
14
bit more
years,
than
man, it's a
14
long
years,
time.
yeah.
Did you always know you wanted to become a gameplay animator or go into games?
Yeah, so well, not an animator. The weird thing is, apparently, like when I was like 7 or 8 years old, my parents told me that like all of my friends wanted to become firefighters or policemen or superheroes when they grow up, and
Sure.
apparently I had said that I wanted to make video games. And my parents said that's not a career,
Sure.
like they do. And then basically, like throughout my childhood, I always knew I wanted to study to make games somehow. I thought I wanted to program because I thought, you know, you need to know programming to make video games. But I tried programming and it was really hard. I'm not smart enough.
Sure.
Not at all. Like, I suck at math. So then I kind of turned to the art side. And then while I applied for a kind of a vocational school in Sweden. So it's like a, what's it called? Like, it's after high school, but it's not really a college, but it's like a vocational school where you study for 2 years and you're supposed to go on internship and you do a lot of projects and stuff like that. So it's not very academic. So I
Sure.
did that, and once I got to try out modeling and concepting a little bit, and like some game design stuff and animation and rigging and such. And yeah, when I got to animation, I was like, okay, this is the best. This is so much fun. I need to do this because it just like, I don't know. It hit the spot of where I wanted to kind of go into video games and kind of tweak how things moved. I just really enjoyed that part.
Gotcha. Have you ever in that moment ever thought about like feature animation as well, like commercial TV?
I mean, yeah, I think that would be a great experience and I think it would be a lot of fun. But I don't know if I'm good enough, to be honest.
I
But
see, I see. Okay.
I think to me, I'm just very, very into the craft of making video games
Sure.
rather than crafting like pure animation, if that makes sense. Like,
Gotcha, yeah.
usually if I make animation, it's about how does this fit into the game? What does this tell the player? How does this tie in with this gameplay system and that
Yeah.
kind of thing? So I usually see myself as a video game builder or whatever, and then I use animation to craft those experiences, if that makes sense.
Yeah. No, that's interesting because I think that's one thing about game animation that's like so interesting because it feels just as more technical as also like the craft side of it. Also, you want to be good at the animation side, but you also want to be technical, knowing the limitations of either the engine or, you know, the rigs built within the game system, kind of like seeing what works and what doesn't and what feels good to the player. So I think that's interesting because like whenever game animators talk about like how they approach certain animation and how they have to make sure that it feels reactive to what the player is pressing, you know, because like in feature anime or whatever, it's like we always think about like, oh, giving it a long anticipation and making sure we're doing all this, but rather in game animation, you know, you kind of have to like just cut that and just kind of go straight into it. So I found that quite interesting of like making the anticipation shorter so that when you press a button, the action is like just comes right out.
Yeah, I think also, I don't know, there was something about like how I got to study animation where I think a lot of animation studies are very focused on creating the animation for the animation's sake, meaning what you see on the screen and the render is what you get. But I think very early on, I mean, the very, very first animations that I made, we put in a game engine.
Mm-mm.
And then you instantly got to see, okay, how does this tie into the control scheme? How does this work with the other animations we need to do for this character? How does how does it relate to the camera when you spin it around and all of that?
Uh-huh.
And I think that just kind of put it in a specific mindset.
Mm-mm.
It's just like a different way of thinking about it, I think, a little bit.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's cool. And with that, I think there were some like questions before that I received from other students, but what would you say, like, compared to, like, because basically, like, you know, I feel like there's always like these two crossroads for a lot of students of like either going into game animation or something more TV, commercial, feature. So like, what would you say it's like either the characteristics of gameplay animation, like what are the, I don't know, like what makes a gameplay animator or gameplay animation versus like feature animation, I don't know, that either interests you or like what students should know about when they're trying to choose between the two as well?
I think it's kind of what we talked about a minute ago, where I think definitely you can swap back and forth. I know a lot of people that have worked a little bit in movies, a little bit in games, and then some film, like again, and then back to games and so on. You can definitely do both. But I think if you're like starting out or trying to pick a lane to focus on, I think it all comes down to like what you're more passionate about.
Mm.
If you're very, very passionate about kind of the technical side of games and trying to make gameplay and game animation flow really well, then that might be your jam. But you should probably go in with the mindset of realizing it's a lot of technical setup, meaning like how it behaves in the game engine and how it relates to a lot of other features in the game.
Right.
Whereas with film animation, it's more you animate what's on the screen and you have your camera cut, like that, you have your shot, and nothing else really matters, right? Unless you're working together with other animators, right, on different characters, but
sure, but
in general. So I think it mostly comes down to what you're more passionate about, to be honest, but you can definitely do either. There's no like barrier there.
Right, gotcha. Actually, before we go further with our questions, I realized we haven't talked about your work per se, like your reel. Do you have a sync sketch link, by the way, that you have?
Oh no, I'm sorry, I can I do not.
I mean, we can just watch your Vimeo, actually, that's fine. And then maybe we can go through, I'll just share it. Let me see, do you have your Vimeo link by any chance?
Second, I can grab it real quick.
Actually, I'm going through your messages. Probably. Sorry, guys. We're going to find it.
Yeah, there. I should have fixed a sync sketch link.
Oh, no.
Sorry. I actually had to like reinstall everything on my computer like yesterday.
No worries.
Because there was something wrong.
No worries. So let's see.
I have the link here.
Boom. There you go. Right here. And then maybe like, as I'm playing it, I know there's gonna be a little bit of delay from your side, from what I'm seeing. Maybe as I play it, maybe you can kind of like talk through either the project that you're on, or you know, maybe something interesting things that went into that. Because I feel like just seeing it, we don't necessarily get the full grasp of like what really went down under the hood. So feel free to like stop me and talk over it. So,
for sure, yeah. I mean, the very first cut is kind of interesting. If you want to start playing it, and then you can kind of pause on her face there.
Oh, right here.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So this is pretty quick, but this was like part of the Overwatch 2 announcement video, where we wanted to present this new character for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And it was pretty interesting. We went through a lot of different ideas for what to do. It's kind of out of context, because in the trailer you see a lot of new things pop up, like new features and whatever, and then we say like, oh, and new heroes, and then we show her face. And we wanted it to be kind of an inviting moment and show kind of the appeal of this character.
Right.
So we spent a lot of time just on this frame, basically making sure that her face felt very warm and kind of confident, and we hope that feeling kind of comes through.
Yeah.
And then we wanted to kind of hint that like that obviously this is a very quick shot, right? But we wanted to hint at what she's about when you see that weapon kind of pop up in the beginning.
Yeah.
It kind of moves and goes, shht. Yeah. I can't really talk about what the character does, and we've shown a little bit more of her since, but it was very, very fun to kind of be part of that little strike team and talk about, okay, how do we show this character the most? And it was like me and the animation director and art director who was involved and so on. We tried to like make it fit within that small time frame and kind of hint as much as we could about this character.
Interesting. Oh, that's cool. Okay.
It's a tricky character to pose too, because I don't know if you can tell, the eyebrows are not very like natural.
yeah.
So it was kind of hard. Like we kept trying to like push and pull and see what we could do with the eyebrows.
But yeah.
Yeah, they're very techy and sci-fi.
Yeah. Gotcha. Were there a lot of controls for the brows, or did you guys have to keep it like, because it does look mechanical? Where is there a limitation to that?
So all of our face rigs are kind of shared. So this the brows have like three main controllers and then a bunch of microcontrollers. So we can pose it, but the more we posed the eyebrows, the less like intact they felt.
Right. Because
they're supposed to feel very sci-fi, kind of like the bits on her cheeks, right?
Yeah.
So they can move a little bit, but as soon as you like start posing it way off or like making a curve out of it, it starts kind of losing its appeal.
Gotcha.
Feeling off model.
Sure. Okay. That makes sense. Cool. And is this the same character?
It is, yeah. Okay. This is from the first person perspective. So this, I was responsible for both first and third person for this character. So here, this was shown publicly during the BlizzCon videos. So yeah, you can go back a bit and show the other cuts again. But yeah, so this is kind of showing off what this character does a little bit.
Uh-huh.
And again, I can't really go too much into... and talk too much about it, but it was a great experience kind of trying to lead a character from the animation standpoint and make sure like her gun felt really good from the first person, make sure that her personality comes through and all the abilities and animations that she does, like down to how she holds the gun, how she reloads and all of that stuff. And then obviously when we can show third person, I think that I hope that people will like her a lot.
Yeah, that's interesting. I'm curious though, because again, I'm so like so new to like the game animation side of things, in terms, especially when it, like the specific details of it, when it comes to like, because it's interesting when you're talking about like the personality and like trying to capture the character even in like the first person animation, is there anything that you guys do or are aware, like try to stay aware of, like when you're designing those first person animation to make it feel different from other characters, to make sure it doesn't feel like copy and paste? Like how do you go about to make it very unique to the character?
Yeah, usually all of that groundwork starts from even the concept phase, right? Like even before you put it in first person at all, or even before we have a model, it's important, like regardless of the game, not only for Overwatch but any first person game, you kind of want to start trying to like build a strong foundation for a character just when you're developing a character for a film, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then hopefully that kind of translates when you put it in first person. Now when you change the perspective on a character, be it third person, first person, whatever, you kind of start realizing that, oh, some of these, like, and this is when blockout animation is really, really helpful, because you start realizing some of these shapes don't work with this camera angle. And this is the same if you work on like a top-down game or something. Like a character might look great, like close-up camera. You put the camera above them, and you're like, wait, I can't see any of those details.
Sure.
Like you only see the head or whatever, and then you might need to like scale things up and change a bunch of shapes and whatever.
Yeah.
And this is what happened here. And any character I've worked on for any game, really, it's like as soon as you start putting it into the game into a set kind of camera angle, you start like realizing, wait, we need to like change a lot of parts to make this read and make it feel cohesive and kind of fit the character and make sure that the amount of detail is appropriate, and like you said, that it's not too similar to other characters.
Mm-mm. That's cool. Someone asked in the question on Twitch, said, how do you deal with those gun shaking animations? Do you use any plugins, or do you do it by scratch?
So I do it from scratch. You can do it in a bunch of different ways, but how I've worked with different systems and different games. On this game, we usually set it up so that one bullet or one shot on the gun is like one animation.
Hmm.
meaning that, like, if you guys can see my camera, like, it's, if it fires just one bullet, it goes bam, like that, right? Mm-hmm. And then it's just a matter of, like, making that feel really, really good. But then you start testing that animation. What happens when you do that animation over and over again, like, you know, 30 bullets a second or something, you know? Right. And then you just need to go back and forth and tweak the animation and tweak the blend times between every bullet until it feels decent, you know? Hmm. Gotcha. And also, like, feedback rounds is so helpful, because what might feel good or look good to you when you, like, work on it or try to make it feel nice might feel too shaky for someone else, you know?
Oh, interesting.
So then you go back and forth and you show the team a lot and you try to collaborate as much as possible to make sure that it makes sense.
Gotcha. And do you test it out? Like, is it different when you see it and also when you plug it into the engine? And then do you, like, also, is that feedback kind of similar in the sense of, like,
Yeah, you always have to test it in the engine.
Okay.
Basically, we usually like to say that, you know, Maya lies, basically, and this is true for any game engine that I've worked in. Things always feel different in a game engine.
Oh, interesting.
Because Maya doesn't interpolate between the frames like a game engine does, especially because in Maya, in game industry, you typically animate in 30 FPS.
Right.
But then the game can run, depending on your monitor, like my monitor is 160 FPS. So I see a lot of frames in between.
Uh-huh.
That you don't see in Maya, so you always have to test things over and over again. But then also having that animation play over and over and how it blends between each animation doesn't behave the same in Maya as it does in the engine. So you always have to test things and iterate and try things out.
Oh, that's cool. Okay, let's let it play out and then feel free to stop me again.
Sure.
Okay.
And then something that is also, like, very important in first person specifically is camera animation. This is true for any game camera, I'd say, like, too shaky and you can get nauseous, but too little and you lose a lot of weight. So this is something you can see here. Like, I put in some work for just what ballistic guns feel like in Overwatch 2 on this character. So on the left, you can see, like, the camera doesn't move at all. On the right, I'd add a little bit of camera. It adds, like, a little bit of oomph, but you don't want to go too far because otherwise people are going to get nauseous and it becomes hard to aim with the crosshair and stuff like that.
Gotcha. Is it just a camera shake, or is there, like, a little bit of, like, some sort of warping that happens, or no?
It's just a camera movement and camera rotation. And then the entire gun and hands are reanimated as well. So the actual recoil animation of the gun is different.
Gotcha. Okay. Cool. Retargetable.
Well, yeah, this is also, like, very game specific, but this is a system where in Overwatch 2, if you run out of health, you go into this, like, downed or incapacitated system where you're out for the fight, but your friends can revive you. It's common in a lot of games.
Right.
But this is so we have a lot of unique characters in the game. So as soon as we add something like this, that kind of multiplies into a lot of animations. If you add it for one, you need to add it for all of them. So with this type of system, it was important that it was easy to retarget it, and it was a type of locomotion that we could reuse for all characters with some, you know, outliers or unique situations. If they're a big mech, for example, they probably can't walk like this.
Yeah. Interesting.
But most of the characters in our cast are bipeds. So it was important to kind of author this in a way that this will make sense regardless of the character.
Oh, interesting.
So I actually started the bottom right was the original. And then the other ones are kind of retargeted from that.
And then from the retarget, did you guys have to, like, do any extra, like, fixes or anything?
Yeah.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, especially on, like, big and bulky characters for sure.
Okay.
And then other characters have, like, you know, big backpacks or whatever, and those need secondary animation. So you have to go in and tweak those separately. But overall, we saved a lot of time by just thinking smart and thinking about what makes sense for a big cast. Mm-hmm. But the nice thing is, later on, if we have time, we can go in, okay, cool, let's make something super unique for these characters or for a certain amount of characters.
Yeah, oh, that's cool. Someone asked the question, does your team mainly focus on new characters, or is there ever time where you guys go back and tweak older animation?
Yeah, so the previous clip is a good example of where we go back and tweak older animations. The previous one with the gun, like here, I redid a bunch of Soldier 76 animations. And this is just an example. We're going to do a bunch of these for different characters.
Gotcha.
But it's kind of, we kind of had to pick our battles, you know, because if we sink too much time into something that was already done in the past, then we might lack time to make something new and exciting instead. So it's always like a trade-off, right?
Gotcha. Okay. Let's continue this.
Cool. Oh yeah. This was an interesting character. So this character, the lead on this character was Matthew Lawrence, one of our animators on the team, or senior animator. And I only helped out with a couple of abilities on this. Because, yeah, we need to ship him for Overwatch Live. And I think specifically, like, there are a couple of interesting things about these. So when he's casting the shield like that, he goes into a different state. So you can hold and, like, cast that shield for as long as you want. And then you can move around while you do it.
Right.
And during some parts of this animation, you can also fire your regular weapon, which means you have full control, but you have a completely different stance now, right? Because he has his left hand in front.
Right.
So that means we need to add like a full locomotion set to this. We could retarget a lot, but we still needed to do a lot of custom fixes. So it's just for a simple ability like this, you still have to think about, wait, the character, the player can still run around and do whatever they want while they use this ability, right?
Right.
So it again just kind of balloons into this, like, oh, we need to add a lot of edge case animations because this could happen. The player can do this.
Ah, interesting.
And then the rock throw animation was a fun collaboration with the effects. We did a lot of back and forth for how the rock would like come out. The direction was that we wanted the rock to feel like he's ripping it out of the ground, basically.
Right.
But you can see we have very few frames to do it on, right? That's very true. Common with the games. It needs to happen when the player hits the button. It needs to happen like right away.
Right.
Or close to it. So we had a very, very little cast time, like with a lot of abilities. So it was a lot of collaboration with effects and animation to see like how quickly can we get this rock into view and how can we kind of use effects to amplify the feeling of that he's kind of ripping those out of the ground with like a magnetic or black hole field or something like that.
Gotcha.
So then actually the rig is basically like each rock piece, except the small pebbles or whatever, but each big rock piece is on a different joint. So I animated each of those to kind of create this like shape.
Interesting. Huh. So when you like pitch an idea like this, do you just pre-visit? Is that what you do? Like you just use this rig and then like just mock up something and then you show it to, I don't know, the FX team and then they kind of like test it with you? Is that what happens?
Yeah, usually. Okay. Yeah. So typically like I like to start off with just a couple of poses, which is, and then I think in this case, I think I started out with just like the, as he's about to just throw the rock out, I just had that pose, and then I just threw it out. And then we just tried that in the game to see if the timing worked.
Yeah.
And that's kind of when I started showing like the animation director and the effects team and so on, and get feedback from all the stakeholders.
Okay, gotcha.
So everyone could weigh in, and game design as well. Need to test everything quite early to see that everything works and kind of hits the fantasy that we're targeting.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
And then after that, you can kind of go in and start doing things in detail. I think the actual rock animations were like the last thing I did. I think that was just like a solid rock or like, you know, the bind pose essentially for a long, long time.
Gotcha.
With this one, we also had to figure out how the handoff to the server works. And this is very technical, nerdy talk, but it's interesting to me with the game, with game development.
Sure.
So basically what is happening is when you rip the rock out of the ground and he's like charging, that's happening on client, meaning that doesn't get sent to the server. But as soon as he punches it out, that becomes a projectile that the server tracks that all the players need to replicate on their machines, right?
Right.
So there's a handoff that happens there, which means that we actually like remove the original rock and spawn a new one at the same location that is traveling out from your camera.
Oh, wow.
If you have a shitty connection,
uh-huh.
it will take some time for that rock to get sent to the server. So we needed to find a way for you to like charge the rock and it gets thrown when the server is ready. So there's actually like a looping, shaking pose in between before the rock gets sent out. But you only see it if you have bad internet.
Gotcha.
Because what we wanted to avoid was like the animation plays and you turn around and then the rock gets thrown in the opposite direction.
Right.
So we need to communicate to the player, like, you haven't thrown this yet.
Gotcha.
So it's just like a lot of stuff you need to get around.
Yeah. Wow. Didn't realize like so much went into that. Wow.
Yeah, sorry, it was too detailed.
Oh, no, it's super cool.
Oh yeah, this was exciting. It was the first hero that I worked on, and I got to do most of the first-person animations on this character. This was a bit unique. I don't know if you want to show the viewers what this character looks like from another camera. If you Google Wrecking Ball Overwatch.
Oh, yeah. Wrecking Ball Overwatch. This guy over here, this guy.
Yeah, so he's a big mech, right? Exactly like in any of these pictures. But yeah, he's a big mech, and it has two guns, and he's controlling it from the top. Now, kind of conveying that from a can't speak, from a first person perspective was kind of tricky. So we kept placing that panel and kept placing those guns in different positions on the camera to see what would feel good. And he's also, I don't know if you can tell, but he has like a small trackball. That's how he controls
That's
the
cute.
mech. That was also like, what is the right amount? Like, how much should that move? How do we make it feel heavy? Do we show the legs in there? Okay, we tried it. No, it was too noisy. It was just flashing on the screen all the time as you walk around. And it's like, no, the guns are too high now. They need to be below him and all of that stuff. It was just like a lot of figuring out, trying to play with the shapes on the screen. And see to kind of replicate that, because you want to, when if you see the character from outside and then you jump into the first person camera, you kind of want to have that feeling of this, what it would like be like from that character's eyes.
Gotcha. Oh, that's cool. Like, and it's so interesting too that like how low you place the character to the screen makes him feel like extra small as well. I think that's kind of cool. Yeah. That's cool. Cool. Okay. And then these are just Overwatch emotes.
Yeah, it's just different emotes that I got to help out with a little bit.
Gotcha.
These are more separate. These are things. The victory poses are things that get shown if your team wins. You get to pick which victory pose you want to display on your character.
Gotcha.
They're kind of fun. These are more like, the animator gets to have fun and pitch ideas to the team, and then usually it's, whatever the team enjoys the most are kind of the ones that get made.
Yeah, no, that's cool. Someone asked a question in the chat. Is the character model we see in the first person same as the what other players see in the third person? They figured it would be two different models to get the camera in the right position to see the hands best as a player.
So it's the same or a very similar. Yeah, it's usually the same model asset, if that makes sense. But it's a separate rig that we animate separately. So it's 100% unique animations, and it's 100% unique like world placement and all of that stuff.
Gotcha.
But it's based on the same model asset.
Okay. Gotcha. Cool. And then now we are getting into Anthem.
Yeah, so this first clip here is from the E3 announcement trailer, which was as a lot of E3 trailers, a lot of smoke and mirrors. But we just the, like the point of the trailer was to show what is this game about, So I think my biggest part here was, yeah, working on the flight system and the jumping system, locomotion in general, overall. But yeah, this was a very challenging game to work on because the gameplay is very, very arcadey and very, Super Mario, and you jump around and fly around like crazy, but the art style itself is very grounded and kind of hyper realistic in a way. So it's kind of tricky to find that like middle ground, but it was very challenging, but a fun project for sure. I learned a ton.
Gotcha. Yeah, no, I remember seeing this like when they showed an E3 and I'm like, oh my goodness, this is gonna be such a like a crazy game. And then I don't know, to be fair, I haven't played it, but the flight system, yeah, it looks so good. Yeah, someone also said in the chat the flight system is like so good and feels
That's
good.
awesome. I'm glad to hear it.
Yeah.
I wasn't there to finish it, unfortunately. I left kind of, what was it, like a year before ship or something like that, or 1.5 year before ship. So other animators added to it, but this was what the flight system was at a time. And this is something I can talk about a little bit, if you want to jump over to my screen real quick.
Okay. There you go.
So this is interesting. So I especially with a lot of games, we talked about shaking a little bit and stuff like that. But the flight system is interesting because it's not it is separate animation assets, but it's also, sorry, it probably looks very weird on the screen. Here we
Okay,
go.
okay. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, so this was what it started with, like basically only trying to find the base poses, what the flight should feel like. So this is basically just a blend space. So I literally have, I think here I had three poses, the middle pose, and then going left, and then going right. That's it. And then you put that in kind of like, yeah, in nodes in the game engine, and then you tell the game engine, like, based on which direction you're going, play this animation, right? So it just blends between them, and then I can tweak the blend values in between, how quickly it blends and so on. And then kind of what I did after that was I added a shake layer. And this is, I remember this one because I literally just took the character in the bind pose and then I just animated each body part so it would shake a lot, like each body part had a lot of turbulence. And then you get this, right? And then you can kind of play with the amount, and especially with Maya layering, you can like add a lot, you can decrease it. And same in a game engine, you can kind of say, like, if you're going up or down, increase the shaking by a lot, or like multiply this additive animation. So this is the shake, it's just a loop that's playing on top of the other poses.
Interesting. Okay.
And then thirdly, what we did was we added the same poses when you go left and right, but you change the blend speed based on the body part. So we would have the legs lag behind. So here you kind of see it all together. So I'm just going back and forth, and you kind of see that the legs kind of go, they lag behind a little bit. And these are literally the same animations, but
Interesting.
I'm literally just blending them slower than the upper body. So it looks like the upper body is leading, and the legs are kind of lagging behind and swiveling around.
That's crazy. I thought when I first saw it, I thought you just had to like animate like just bunch of those animations and then have them blend. But you figured out a way to like kind of do that automatically for you just by
Yeah,
using it.
exactly. And then there was another bunch of them added. Like here, you can see that the arms are kind of static here. That was fixed later, and we have different poses for going up and down. And there were a bunch of fixes after this. But yeah, that was kind of like the base of the system.
Oh, that's so cool. Gotcha. Dang, that's crazy.
Yeah,
Wow.
it's fun. I love that kind of thing where you just like put things in and experiment to see kind of what feels the best. And it's always when I get a task in working on a game, it's always like, okay, like how can I kind of puzzle this together?
Dang. Yeah, work smarter, not harder,
Well, most of these features too is something I had never done before. So it's always like, what should we do? Let's try this.
right? Gotcha. Man, no, that's cool. Okay, so let me just finish sharing this. So, and then this
Yeah,
is
you can take back the
the.
screen again.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, this is just showing some of the base locomotion stuff in Anthem. So they're kind of sharing the base setup in the engine. It was all based on the exosuit on the left, and then basically we just authored custom content for the other suits. But they're all kind of, the setup is the same. So these were actually, I think we had like, was it like a walk slow, a walk fast, a jog, and a run, and then a sprint that we don't see here. And based on your input, meaning like how much you're pushing the stick on your Xbox controller, for example, it changes the animation play depending on the speed that you have, right?
And it because the one on the right, obviously it's like a heavier model. So like is this just sharing the same animation but just slower? Is
No,
it?
it's unique animation content, but it's the same setup in the
Oh,
engine.
I see, I see, I
So
see.
we basically built the left character with the left suit to basically almost finished, except for polished. And then we realized, okay, or then we knew at least, like, okay, this is the animation content we need to get this experience or this result. Let's build it again, but for a different for the other suits and other characters.
Cool.
Oh yeah, and this was just showing a little bit of the shooting experience where, and again, it's a lot of reusing animations for different kind of move sets because you can move around a lot in this game.
Yeah.
But we didn't want have to make completely different gun animations and shooting experience animations for depending on if you're in air or on the ground or looking in different directions and stuff like that. So it was just showing some of that. And this was just something that we also tried to push on Anthem was the idea of having kind of a first person viscerality of combat.
Yeah.
But in the third person camera, because in a lot of games it kind of gets lost. So we really try to think about the silhouette of the character, think about can you see what weapon you're wielding. We really want to show off the weapon as you reload, all of those things.
Yeah, no, I was about to ask you, like, is it more challenging to figure out like a third person shooting kind of action versus like a first person shooting in terms of like the complexity of it? Like, is it more difficult to do a first person versus third person, or is that just the same?
I think it's about similar complexity.
Okay.
I think they just have a little bit of different challenges.
Gotcha.
I would say if anything, I think third person is a little bit easier because you can kind of tweak the camera, you can tweak the entire character to show more. In first person, you're so locked, right? Like you can only show so much before you start covering too much of the screen.
Right.
But it's I would say it's similar in mindset.
Gotcha. Makes sense. Cool. And then
I think in first person though you can cheat way more, right?
Right. That's true.
Because you can show things off camera that you can't show. Like in third person, you see the entire character, so I can't cheat when you don't see the hands, right?
Right.
But we do that in first person all the time. Like if you do a reload, like those, as soon as a hand is outside of the camera, it's probably very broken and weird because it needs to like fit into the next part of the animation.
Gotcha.
So in third person, you need to be more like controlled,
right?
More real,
less can't cheats. Cheat. Yeah. Gotcha. Cool. And then I think your last clip is like your Python scripts.
Oh yeah, this is just a couple of examples of scripts that I had done. It was something that I've enjoyed in recent years is kind of learning Python and think about like, okay, I do this thing a lot manually in Maya and it takes me a lot of clicks. How can I do that with just a button or a tool? Or
yeah.
A tool that allows me to just try it over and over again and iterate.
Gotcha. Yeah. Yeah, again, it's working smarter, not harder. That's cool.
Yeah, and it's a very humbling experience because I feel way too dumb to know any of this stuff. So,
sure. Yeah.
but it's a lot of fun. You just kind of gotta swallow your pride and ask a lot of people for
advice.
And
yeah,
read a lot.
Yeah. Would you say that, especially for students who are looking into going to game animation, that they should kind of use? Obviously, this would help anyone, but I feel like, especially specifically more for game animation, would you encourage students to like learn a little bit more of the technicality of everything, and like maybe, you know, it would be helpful to like know scripts, like scripting and whatnot?
I feel like that's more advisable for people that want to go into technical animation or technical artistry, rigging and that kind of thing. That's more expected there. For animators, this is not really expected. This is just something that I got really into. Okay. Obviously, it can be really, really helpful. And it can increase your value on a team if you can make tools that make workflow way more efficient. And it's also like just nice to be able to improve your own workflow in these ways. But it's not something that is expected at all. So I'd say if you want to go very technical, then I'd probably focus more of my time on actually learning game engines and how game animation setups work before I would learn any type of coding.
Gotcha. Okay. Yeah, nice. Someone asked questions like, what are the most in-demand skills for a modern AAA game animator? So if you're hiring someone, what would be those skill sets that you would love to see?
So something that is typically very, very hard to find is animators that have kind of an interest, I guess, in gameplay setups and figuring out how things work under the hood without a lot of support. And I feel like this has been a trend for content creators over the years, not only for animators but also artists and designers. I feel like in the past when I started out in game development, it was a lot of I make my animation, I toss it over the fence to the programmer and he'll send me a video of what it looks like in the game.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, okay, that's not quite right, let me tweak that. or I tell him, change the blend to this or something like that.
Yeah.
Because there weren't any like graphical interfaces. It was all just like big text files with code that said what the animations would do. But I feel like over the years, now you see Unreal and Unity and with all the visual scripting, right? Mm-hmm. And that's why I, as an animator, a game animator, I feel very empowered because I can go in and I can build these animation behaviors with tools that engineers have given us, right? Mm. So I think kind of spearheading that and something that we, or at least me, get really impressed by when I see a demo reel is when an animator put in their content into a game engine in context, even if it's just a run cycle in a third person template in Unreal Engine and showing, look, this run cycle is nice and it works really well in Unreal Engine. It's like, okay, sweet, you tried it and you iterated through and made sure it works to camera and that it works with the blend values and all of that stuff. And then you can kind of develop from there. So I think stuff like that is very, very rare.
Interesting. Gotcha. Yeah, because that's like one thing I've always thought of is like, you know, that's something I wanted to like also get myself into. Is like if I ever wanted to go into games, I don't want to just like put up a like a feature animation reel and send it to game studios and be like, here, I can animate. But I think it's more valuable for game studios to know that how can you apply what you know from animation to, you know, to what you would expect to see in a game, and then seeing how a character, you know, would fit in the context of the game, especially in the style of that studio that they're going for. Do you find a lot of like, especially like artists who are like new, who are trying to get into getting animation like as a junior, do you see a lot of, is there something that you would wish that the junior animators would try to cater their reel specifically to, like something that you've seen more as a pattern that maybe as a tip to either avoid or something to add to their reel that will help them to get noticed by studios?
It's a very good question. I think overall, it's if you want to get into games, realize that you are going to send content to game developers, and game developers will be impressed by games or projects that you have built that are catered to games. They will probably be less impressed by an acting shot,
right?
And then vice versa for film, right? You want to cater the content to the studio that you're applying, right?
Right.
A film studio probably wouldn't care that much about the setup you have in Unreal Engine.
Gotcha.
Right? So I think it's mostly that.
Yeah.
And I think also something that I usually think a lot about is that we would rather, I say we, but this is like the this has been the same at most studios I've worked at. We'd rather hire a hungry person that wants to learn, that is easy to talk to and willing to communicate a lot, over someone that thinks they have all the answers and is a killer animator, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So it's about being humble and about being willing to learn, right, and getting to the weeds and understand how things work and learn from others.
Gotcha. Cool.
And basically showing your work in context of a game environment on a game engine kind of shows that, right? Because it shows that you're not only in it for the grand art of animation. No, you're actually like also willing to get nitty gritty and learn these complex systems and get out of your comfort zone a little bit.
Gotcha. Then would your suggestion be like, let's say like a junior animator who, you know, who's trying to get their foot in the door in their game animation, then they have never touched, like, let's say Unreal Engine before. Is this something that you would suggest that they actually try to put their animation within that engine and then, like, you know, use that as like the play blast to put into their reel versus mocking up something in Maya, you know, that kind of looks like a game, but it's obviously just done through Maya? Or would you suggest that they actually try learning just like the basics of the Unreal Engine to kind of help them to get to stand out?
I think so, for sure. I think anytime someone shows me the material that is in a game engine, that is in context, it hooks me way more than just seeing a Maya play blast.
Interesting.
Now, putting it into context in a game engine won't hide poor animation, right?
Sure.
So it probably needs to be good animation first and foremost, right?
Sure.
But the thing also is that that's what I talked about, like personality and being open to communication, willing to learn. that it's usually, if you see flaws in an animation or something like that, you can usually teach that. And that's also something that comes up during interview processes and feedback processes, like how well does a person take feedback? How well do they learn? Because like, I'm always willing to train someone up. You can usually train someone to be a great animator, but it's very hard to train someone how to be a better learner.
Sure. Yeah, gotcha. Yeah, I think that rings true for just in general, even like just any workplace, I'm sure, like just being a good teammate to have versus like a super talented artist who is like really hard to work with, you know?
Yeah.
So I feel like exactly. Supervisors, leads, they always prefer someone who's just easy to work with and who is willing to learn versus like a top star animator or artist who might be like, I think they're all that kind of thing, right?
Yeah, exactly. Gotcha. No, that's totally it. And it's pretty clear when you talk to people and interview people, and if a person is humble and really eager to learn, and that's why I love, like, for me it's always really tough to know a person or how good a person is at their job just from their portfolio, because there's so much that goes into it, right, in terms of personality and soft skills or whatever you want to call it, right?
Sure. Yeah, that's true. And this was a question from before, but what would you say your specialty is within gameplay animation? Like, what is it? What are the things that you like to do? If like specifically in game animation, like, you know, like specific type of action, like big energy, or you know, what is it that drives you?
I think that's a very good question. I think that's still something that I'm trying to figure out. I typically enjoy doing most things, but I also think that I'm very easily bored. So I like trying new things, and I like trying to figure out new systems and that kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
But I don't like dislike any type of specific action. Mm-hmm. But I think what I'm very drawn to, especially in real time, you know, action games, is the tactility and intuitivity of what the controller feels like. What does it feel like when you push the jump button? What does it feel like when you hit the shoot firing button, or whatever it is, even if it's a gathering game? Like, what does it feel like when I go up to like an item and try to pick it up, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like the tactility of it and what it feels like to interact with that world. I think that's something that I'm very, very drawn to, right?
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
No, it's cool. Like in a gathering game, like I love, for example, in Firewatch, I remember, I don't know if anyone played that game, but it's if you pick up resources or pick up items in that world, they just have like this swipe animation across the screen, and the thing that you picked it up from kind of wobbles, and it just goes ftink, like it's just very satisfying. And yeah. If you get something like that right, like it's just
gotcha. In terms of, let's see, I mean, this is a question that kind of was asked, like kind of like a what goes in a real kind of thing, but maybe just kind of to talk a little bit more about it, of are there shots that you wish that students would stop including in their reel, especially when they apply to game studios, and what are the type of shots that you wish you saw more? So obviously one of them being seeing the animation context. But yeah, you want to talk more about that?
Yeah, I think that's probably a big thing, seeing it in context. Not sure about stop seeing. One thing that has bothered me as of late is, and I don't know if I just haven't seen it enough before or if it's a recent trend, but I don't want to dismiss it completely. So it's just a thing I've noticed. But basically, I've seen a lot of shots from people that are trying to learn animation where they animate the camera a lot. And then I'm really curious, what does that animation look like if you put the if you freeze the camera?
No, interesting.
What does the animation look like, right? What are the body mechanics? Because sometimes you have like a jumping character that are doing all of these action-y things and running around. The camera like shakes like crazy. And it's very immersive and very cool and would work in a movie, right?
Yeah.
But I'm like, okay, freeze the camera. How is it moving? Like, how does that work? What are the body mechanics, right?
Gotcha.
And it's just very hard for me sometimes to kind of understand or judge a shot or someone's animation skill when they, you know, hide things with the camera, I guess. But the thing is, like, the camera animation is really important too, so I don't want to dismiss it completely, right?
Sure.
Because it is really important. Yeah, it's just for me as a game animator, I guess.
Gotcha. Great. And then this was another question. In the current like AAA game animation market, should animators like know mocap or learn mocap, and like what type of like mocap duties or, you know, responsibilities, like especially for a junior animator, like how would you go about, I don't know, because maybe it is harder to teach them mocap earlier on if they haven't ever tried it, but would you say that mocap is pretty big, like in terms of like what you should know when you're trying to get into the industry as well?
I think motion capture is a tool just like anything else, and if you know animation, then you can just use motion capture. And then I think when it comes to like recording it and cleaning it up and that kind of thing, that's way more technical work. That's more, yeah, typically done by, you know, a mocap studio or technical artists on the team. Gotcha. I've worked on teams where we did it ourselves. It's not fun, but I think that's pretty rare as far as game animators go. But to me, for example, like when I tried motion capture for the first time, I had already worked with some hand keyed animation, and then jumping into motion capture is not super different. It's just, mm-hmm. you have to kind of pick up workflows, how to parse like really dense data, because it's all super baked, right?
Right.
And you kind of start ripping out things you don't need, and you keep the things that you need, and you start working very layered and that kind of thing.
Right.
I think that's probably when I started using animation layers the most.
Mm.
And then I just kept that when I worked with keyframed. But I don't think it's something that you need to specifically focus on. Mm-hmm. But having that said, sure, I think if you want to add more things to your reel, you can always download free motion capture online,
right,
and then kind of show before and after you polished it up. Sure.
Gotcha.
It doesn't hurt, you know.
Sure. Great. Okay. Yeah. So I think that's the previous questions from before. Did you want to share, I know you had something prepared. Did you want to share some of your tips and tricks?
Yeah, I can just show like a couple. It's nothing big. It's just like I can just kind of show a couple of things, how I like to work. I can show a couple of scripts.
Sure.
Yeah, I think we can probably go through a couple of the scripts that I made that I find useful for myself.
Gotcha.
So 1 second. Let's see where did my GitHub go?
Sure.
So anybody, I'll link it in the stream, but anybody can actually just go and download a bunch of my scripts.
Oh, awesome.
If they want to.
And then for those who are watching, feel free to post your sync sketch links if you have reels or work that you want to show, and then we can go over that as well. But cool.
Yeah, so and I mean, like, I'm very, very beginner at scripting tools, but it's something that I keep doing. I have a bunch that aren't done, but these are like a couple that I use that I find very, very useful, that I use all the time. Mm. But one that I found myself, I don't know why I haven't used this before, but for example, like, I don't know what a good part to show this on, but this one, just a simple locator at selected. Sometimes you want to keep a certain position in the world, and you want to store it for later. So I just click this button, and then I get a locator at this exact location.
Gotcha.
Let's see, where is it? Oh, I'm hiding locators, I think. There we go. Which is very useful.
Yeah.
So then I can save that for later. It doesn't matter what body part it is, but for some reason, if I wanted to keep those values in the world, right?
Oh, that's pretty cool.
But then what I can also do is I just added so that sometimes I need to bake it down, or maybe I need to save this and put it into another scene, right? Mm-hmm. So then I can just do bake to selected. So now again, I have a new locator. Let's make it bigger, but it actually has a bunch of keys on it, and it's baked down the foot. So if I change the foot, whatever.
Yeah.
I always have that. I always have this to go back on, right? And the nice thing about this too is I can just copy the curves that I need and paste it onto others if I need it later, right?
Yeah.
If I don't need it, I can just hide it or whatever.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
And especially with rigs like this, this one I just downloaded, so mm-hmm. cool League of Legends rig, that it doesn't have like all the nice tools of, you know, parent space matching and that kind of thing.
Right.
So then you can see here that I've actually used a locator here that is kind of my own little setup where I had animated this, but I wanted to change the parent space.
Hmm.
But if I do that, the entire animation gets mucked up.
Right.
And then it was very nice to just bake down the animation to a locator, change the parent space, and then bake that down to the new parent space.
Gotcha. That's pretty cool.
It's just a nice little thing to have. My next development of this tool would be that I actually want another button here where I store it somewhere on the C drive or whatever, so I don't have to use Studio Library or something to pass it on to another scene.
That's cool.
Because it's something that I do a lot too. Like very often I might be like, okay, I need this curve in this other scene, and then I just do this, and then I have that locator, and then I save this out in like Studio Library or whatever, and then bring that into another Maya scene, and then now I have this and I can use it for whatever.
That's cool. Gotcha.
Yeah. Another thing overall too is reusing curves, kind of in the same vein of using locators, is I think a lot of animators have talked about this online. There are a lot of video guides about it, but basically reusing curves where you can, because you don't need to reanimate everything, right?
Right.
So a good example is like the up down in a run. I can use this for a lot of things because it's the entire movement, right?
Mm-hmm.
So let's just delete all of the hair animation. Real quick, this is a button I use more than you'd think. Clear animation and animbot.
Yeah, I bet that's hockey.
Yeah, it's really useful. Let's just zero all of this out like that. Mm-hmm. So let's just copy this, and then I actually want to add this to the up and down of this hair piece, right? So just make that, and then this is really bonkers, right?
right.
So set a key. Or I mean, yeah, can just do this handy thing.
Mm-mm.
And I don't know if people know what this does, but yeah, it's a global offset. So whatever I changed to one key, it will apply it to all of them.
Gotcha.
On selected. And then obviously it moves a ton, but it's nice because then I can see what the hell is going on.
Right.
And I set it to looping, and then I push this forward a little bit to get that delay.
Right.
And then I scale it down a bunch, and then maybe probably smooth it a little bit.
Sure.
Something like that. And there, now I have like a nice up and down bobbing motion on the hair, and I didn't have to animate it. It was just like reusing the curve.
Yeah. No, that's awesome.
And like I do that all over the place, like reusing rotation on the hip and put it on the spine. The up and down, I put it from the hip, on the arms, on the shoulders, on the hair, on the head, like on everything as much as I can, right?
Right.
So yeah. I have everything in sync, and even if it ends up looking weird, at least I have a curve that I can kind of start editing and changing, right?
Yeah.
And it kind of, it's easier than starting from nothing to me.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
And then other simple workflow stuff like animating this kind of, it's not perfect, but animating this kind of thing can be obnoxious, especially if you're in like FK or something.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, so basically what I did was I used my tool, locate to selected, and bake that down, and then I move it out of the way. Back, this is backwards for some reason. Put it over here, roughly.
Uh-huh.
And now my locator is down there, right?
Sure. Uh-huh.
And then you can just take the FK controller of this and aim constrain it.
Yeah, right.
And this is pretty, very, very common for a lot of animators, but it's something that took me ages.
No, it's super cool.
Yeah, and this is like 1-to-1 now, right? But then I can just take this and like push it. And then kind of just find what I want, right? And find that delay, put it, set it to looping, and move it, and then maybe I want probably scale this up like a ton.
Right.
Scale from average probably works better. Whoop, like that, right?
Yeah.
And then you just keep going like that, and then once you're happy with whatever, you just bake it down and remember to delete the constraint.
Mm-hmm. Here. Right. Oh, that's pretty cool. Nice.
Yeah. So I used the locator thing quite a bit.
Yeah.
Anyways, I'm kind of jumping around all over the place. Other tools that I use that I have written, and these are more available on my Gumroad page. Mm-hmm. 1 second, let me actually bring it up.
Cool.
As I said, I reinstalled everything. So.
No, that's fine. Take your time. Let me see. There was a question about someone asking about how you deal with gimbal lock during when the cog is in a flipping motion, like a front flip or twisting. Is there anything that you do to to avoid frame by frame to fix that, or is that kind of how you have to address it a lot of times?
It depends. Actually, the other week at work, I had to deal with that, and I actually had to frame by frame animate it because it was something that was flipping from one direction to another.
Mm.
But yeah, typically I try to rely on just the Euler filter in Animbot quite mm-hmm. a bit. I use this a ton.
Yeah, yeah, the smart Euler filter.
And then other than that, to avoid it, I actually do a lot of kind of what you saw with the locator. I utilize a lot of parenting. So if something is gimbaling a lot, let's say I needed to flip something over.
Mm-hmm.
If I just create a locator that is parented to world instead.
Right.
Let's just see here if I can do a quick demo. That's so weird. So, like this. It's really quick. Oh. So, yeah, so let's say this was like this, right? Mm-hmm. Like it had like a weird gimbally thing going on, whatever, right? Uh-huh. And I needed to flip this. Well, if I just put that under the locator, this is in world, so I can just animate this.
Right, right.
So that's also how I go around it with locators a lot. Mm-hmm. I try to animate the parent of things, and then I bake it down.
Right, smart.
If I need to, or I keep the setup. But so one thing to notice too about these types of things is I rarely like to leave them in the scene, mm-hmm. especially if another animator needs to open it up, and they will go, what the hell are all these locators and all these constraints? What, nothing makes sense.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's important to clean up your work, or at least to me. That's why if you do the aim constraint trick on the hand, for example, make sure to bake that down, and you can also remove keys that you don't need if you feel like it.
Right.
But yeah, same thing with this kind of thing. If you needed to flip, okay, animate your thing, and then bake it down and remove the locator and then go from there, you know?
Gotcha.
Yeah, and if you have tools like this, it's pretty fast to kind of recreate those setups if you need to do it again.
Yeah, no, that's super cool.
That's kind of how I go about it. This is probably one of the first tools that I wrote, but I use it surprisingly often, especially in games when you need to do a lot of variations of something or directions of things.
Yeah.
So let's say I wanted to make this into a strafing animations. There are a lot of different ways you can do it, mm-hmm. but let's say I wanted this foot to go side to side instead of forward and back. So I would just take swap, translate, Z and X, boom. Now it goes side to side. And it literally, that's all it does. It just swaps. It just swaps the curves. It does nothing else.
How interesting.
So you do that, and you do that with both feet, set an X, and then you can do it with rotate and a bunch of other things and whatever. And then you can use Animbot to kind of invert the rotate or whatever you want to do, right? But it just gives you a starting point.
Yeah, no, that's cool.
I don't know if that's something that comes from my motion capture days, but I just enjoy having keys to pull around and play with rather than starting from zero.
yeah Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, so this I use this more often than you'd think.
Neat.
And then this one is really useful if you do a lot of locomotion directions. Wait, something is busted. There we go. Weird Python issue. So this is probably easier to do in a new scene, to be honest.
Cool.
So let's say you had a character and you need to, it needs to run in a set direction. Let's just set this to, there we go. And you need it to move in both forward, backwards, right, left, and also diagonal. In this direction, right?
Right.
making all of those layers for that, for those directions, and also like doing the math for this is obnoxious. So then you can just say in centimeters, I want this character to move 5.5 meters per second. It needs to move west, east, which is left and right speed, well, the same speed, and then backwards, slightly slower. It's like typical game engine stuff.
Oh, interesting.
And these values you would typically get from your game designers, and you try it out in game and see what feels good, right? And then you just hit this, and then you get all of these layers. So now you have, you know, the movement speed of this.
Oh,
I think the scale is off in this scene.
Yeah, it's like super fast.
Yeah, exactly. What is this? Centimeters. There we go. That's probably better. Gotcha. Damn it.
Yeah.
I should have scaled this up first. Why won't it let me? Oh.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Here we go. Stupid. I was too eager. There we go.
There
okay.
Yep.
Yeah. So now you have the north movement, which is forward, and it just sets like this curve, and it just goes on forever. And then you have the east and west, and you have northwest for free, because that's like a different math. It's you use what's it called? I don't know what the English name for it. Pythagorean theorem.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Which is, you know, high school math or whatever.
Yeah.
But this was just something to speed it up, because working on different characters, these are like tools that I, or layers that I set up more often than you'd think.
Huh. Interesting.
So usually when I work on a run cycle, you have this layer here called speed ref, and this is actually just like a layer that is just over 30 frames. It runs, this is weird scales, but it's 5.5 meters a second, right? When I made this animation. But then I need it for all the other ones, right? So then I can just run this tool, burp, and now it has it on those.
I see.
Yeah. I think this is backwards actually, but yeah.
Oh, no, that's
this is based on like the scale that I normally work in. So this character is really, really giant, I think. So it's all weird. But basically you see the concept.
Yeah.
Should probably add it here so you can actually change the scale of this, but I guess I can just go. If I actually just add it to here, boom, boom, this should probably fix it.
Gotcha.
Like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's inverted because this character for some reason is facing negative Z, but which is weird.
Right.
But anyways, yeah. So then you get all of these for free, right? And then you can just start animating on top of this. So it just helps quite a bit.
No, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. I think that those are like the most interesting ones, to be honest.
Cool.
Yeah. And then I probably have a bunch of others, but... this one is pretty cool. This one I can share. I don't remember who made this, and I don't remember where I found it. But this is very nice if you like working with the graph editor up a lot, like I do.
Mm-hmm.
Someone just made a script where you have the graph editor with a transparency slider.
Oh, no way.
So you can just have this and like work on your scene and still interact with the graph editor, but it's transparent.
No way. How do selections work then? So if the graph editor's on top, you will select the graph editor, right? Like.
Yeah, okay, exactly. Gotcha. Yeah. So if I drag here, it's still the graph editor.
That's neat.
Yeah. But it's just like I don't like spreading things out between monitors. So just like having everything, so my attention is in this one space. So this can be really, really nice. But yeah, it is kind of confusing. Why can't I grab it? And then right.
No, right? That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's pretty nice.
Because I know like there's you know, there are like places like you have like pickers that's like transparent, which helps to save like space. But I never thought of like graph editor being transparent too.
Yeah,
it's pretty cool.
Did I add this to the GitHub? I'm not sure.
Hmm.
It is on the GitHub, actually. Oh, okay. Yeah, credits to someone who made this. I don't remember, to be honest, and I'm very sorry about that. It was a long time ago I found it.
Cool. No, that's neat. Yeah. Awesome.
Cool.
Okay.
But yeah, for sure. And then other stuff that I just like doing, and I can show that in here, why not? Let me just reload this scene. So this is also something that that I really enjoy on rigs, and I did my own setup here because this rig doesn't have it.
Mm-hmm.
But I really like having a hip controller above the main hip controller.
Mm-hmm.
And what that allows me to do is always having a leveled aligned to world controller for the character, right?
Right.
So you see that he's posed like with this, right? With the hip controller. And then on top of it, I added this other root offset, basically, which is above it, which is nice because this is always aligned to world.
Right.
So this is where I put all my translation.
Smart. Gotcha.
And then this I can do whatever with, but I know that I will always have this that is like leveled to the world.
Gotcha.
And it just makes it easier, which means I don't put any rotation on this, but I can put both rotation and translation on this.
Mm. Yeah, smart.
And this rig didn't have it, but it's easy to add. Like, you literally just add a curve and just parent constrain it.
I see.
Yeah. But it's in the only thing is important to do it with a group. So this rig luckily had groups on it. So this is the controller, which is here. But then it has groups called target and position. So then I constrained the target group to my new controller, which means that since this actual controller is below that group, I can still animate this even though it's constrained.
Gotcha. Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, and that's kind of how I do it with, if I constrain things to locators and stuff like that too, I try to use groups as much as possible. So I can always constrain a group and then put things in that group, and then I can animate things within the group while it's constrained.
Yeah. Or something. Cool. That's awesome.
Yeah. I can also, someone mentioned shakes earlier. I can show a little bit about that.
Ooh, okay.
I have a couple of different ways to do it. Let's just do this. So I have a couple of different ways to do shakes. I'm sure, like, to people that do this a lot, this is probably very, very standard.
Mm-hmm.
This is actually, I don't know how to bring out the IK controllers on that rig after I swap it to FT. So let's do a clean one or whatever.
Okay.
There we go. That's the rig. There we go.
Cool.
Just hide this and then put this to 30 because I don't know how to work in 24. But my brain doesn't work in 24 frames a second. So let's say I wanted to add some shake onto this, right? But I've already animated something.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say, like, it's a big swirling motion or whatever. I usually like to create a new layer. You just call it shake. You can call it whatever you want. And then add it to the layer. And then, so I have two different ways of doing this. Either depending on, because sometimes I don't know the frequency I want.
Mm.
But I know usually for a game it needs to loop, right?
Right.
So I usually set two keys like that. Bring up the graph editor. And then I set it to looping. Mm. And then I start like moving things like this. Gotcha. And then just see, okay, what does that feel like?
Mm.
And then add it to X. Okay, well, that's the same, right? So then I set that to looping and move it over one. Okay, now it's a bit less. I don't think this is actually doing much. Oh, there we go.
Mm-hmm.
There we go. So do that, and then maybe set that to looping. Okay, it's kind of feeling cool.
Uh-huh.
Maybe I want to add another one here to kind of muck it up a bit. And then I just like keep adding things and changing tangents and whatever.
Sure.
Until it kind of does what I want, right?
Yeah.
And if you want to add like to this, you can bake it down or like copy all the keys like that. And then keep pasting it. And then you can start changing the curves, right? Or you can just bake it down with whatever frequency you need and then start editing it. And then you have like a nice base to start it on. And since it's on a layer, you can also just like, I just want to turn it off. I don't want it right now, or I only want like half or whatever. You don't need to change all the curves. You can just do this, which is, to be honest, when I do shakes, I tend to, for some reason, do it like huge. So I see what's happening.
Yeah,
and then before I export to a game or whatever, I just lower this.
Gotcha.
So I don't lose like that, and then I can just decrease it if I need to, and then I can decrease it if I need to.
Gotcha. And then do you just key the weights whenever you wanted to just end it? Like if you wanted to just have a section of the shake?
Yeah, so that was the next thing that I was gonna show. Another thing that I do, and yeah, I've done that too, like animate this so it goes up and down throughout the animation. Like
Sure.
if something's charging up, like I tend to do that, and especially if it's a looping shake like this. But
Right.
the other way that I like to do, I can probably do like way shorter for this. And this is actually another. I have another tool that I just realized. Oh, here. This is I use this a ton too. Sometimes you want a bunch of keyframes, but you don't want to use the bake feature. So I literally just hit this button, meh, and then it just sets a key on
That's
whatever
nice.
value it is, right?
Yeah.
And then from here, I would just like grab all this and then use the crazy noise thing he has in here, which is super useful. Just do that. Warp. And then don't know. Oh, it's not big enough, most likely.
Oh, yeah, this.
Probably because the scale is so crazy.
Yeah. Dang.
Really?
Is that not affecting it?
Doesn't seem to be. Let's create a new one. I had some bug the other day with Oh, maybe I had the layer weight. Layer
Oh.
weight on zero? Yeah, it was on
Okay,
zero. There we go.
okay. Gotcha.
Wee!
There you go.
Like that.
Yeah.
So this is shaking like crazy. And now it's, yeah, like you mentioned, it's really nice to just have this. So I can set this to zero and I can set it to one at the end. And it goes like that, right?
Yeah.
And then you can just like actually tweak the curve here. So if I need to have like a slower ramp up, I can do that, right?
Right.
Do that. Mwah, right?
Right.
And then yeah, if it needs to peak in the middle and go down layer later,
Cool.
stuff like that. Zip.
That's pretty cool. Yeah.
And then if you want to, obviously you can just go in and then like tweak all of this noisy stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah. And then obviously, whoa. This noise thing is pretty cool because it can also, if you go to the right, it creates a wave instead of so yeah, so you can do that too.
That's cool. Yeah.
But
Yeah.
yeah.
It's cool. Yeah. No, I love using, I feel like there's like so much like potential to like layer animation that it helps in so many ways and saves so much time. Yeah, I love it.
Yeah, something else that I use layers for a lot, especially for something like this, is I don't know, I kind of like in this animation, there's not a lot of fancy stuff going on. It's very default. Like there's not a lot of squash and stretch or anything.
Yeah.
But then if I want to add some, I like to add the controllers that I want to do it on and then add it to layers. I don't know. So sometimes I would add some translation on the base animation, but then if I really want to try crazy stuff, I like having it on layers. So just probably call it a spine stretch or something.
Right.
It's important to label your layers. Again, if someone else needs to go into your scene, it's important.
Yeah.
And then basically like now here you can start like trying like a bunch of bonker stuff, right?
Right.
And animate it. And then again, like I like making broad strokes and fix it later.
Right.
So you can do something like this. And then set this to zero. And then, whoa, this is really weird. And then maybe you want to delay it a little bit. Do that.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. And then you can just lower this to whatever you want, right?
Yeah, no, that's pretty cool.
And then you know that it's all contained in there. And it's easy to reduce this separately.
Yeah, especially if you got a note or something, it's like, oh, can you reduce that? Then you can just easily go into a layer and reduce it.
Exactly,
Yeah.
yes. For sure, yeah.
That's cool.
But yeah.
Awesome. No, thanks for showing us that.
For sure, yeah. I have yeah, I can I realized I can show one more thing.
Sure.
So I actually don't know. I feel like a lot of animators have very different ways of making run cycles or walk cycles or locomotion cycles in general. Like different animators start out different stages.
Sure.
Let's see, animus. think I saved one here. Yeah. So this is, and okay, warning. This is really ugly.
It's fine.
This is all my animations are super ugly. So I like working layered in terms of body parts as well. So typically, how I start out is, like, you know, get the reference and all those things and try to figure out who's the character and like how should the character move, and you get speed info from either the director most likely or the game designer in my case usually, like what's the movement speed of this character. And then you set the move speed on a separate layer so you know how fast they move, and then I literally, if this was a character from a game, I would typically take the idle pose, but here I just like mucked something up. And then I literally just make the legs move according to that speed. And then I have this on a layer, so I can just mute it and work in place. And I know I have zero foot sliding.
Right.
Because I do, I work with that from the start, so I don't need to fix that. I have that.
Yeah.
What's nice about this, that only the legs are moving, is that it's very, very easy to change. It's really easy for me to go in and change, let's say this character now moves a little bit slower, like that. Now you have foot sliding. Okay, then you just go in and start fixing it. And this is also where I would use my, my locator thing.
right, in the world space. Gotcha.
Yeah, exactly. So I do that, and then on this frame, it needs to be where this is. So I just snap,
snap it. Right.
Then fixed. You know, and then typically I just mirror that over to the other, to the other foot.
Yeah.
Do this and then grab that. Use our handy clear animation. I should put that on like on a shortcut.
Yeah, and then then offset it, right? Yeah.
Bloop. Like that, and now it moves slower with no foot sliding.
Right.
Together with that, it's also really easy for me at this stage to see what should the cadence be for the character. Sometimes, so other people don't like scream when they see it, I might put some up and down on the hip
because
it helps people put their future goggles on. But yeah, so it's really easy for me to just throw this into the game or show other people and see, does this feel about this, the right cadence? Because sometimes you want it to take more steps per second or whatever, right?
Right.
So like, okay, can we try this run cycle with 15 frames, 16 frames, 17 frames, or 24 frames length and that kind of thing, but the same movement speed? So I have this reference that just, the speed reference that just keeps going if I want to, right? So I can just, if I feel like it, let's, what would it feel like if the run was 30 frames long? And then it would only be two steps over 30 frames, right? So
right,
at this stage, it's really easy for me to just push and pull things and see what should the cadence be, right?
Yeah.
Because I've noticed sometimes I've tried to use the workflow where I just start with the up and down on the hip and just find the right feel.
Yeah.
But then I've often felt like I often have to go back and change it later anyway. Because, yeah, it, but either way works for sure. Different people work in different ways. So it all works out in the end. But this is just a way that makes sense for my brain, I guess, to figure out the cadence of it. And then I start adding things on the hip and the spine and everything.
Gotcha. Oh, that makes sense. That's cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. Great.
But yeah, I've blathered on. Blabbed on for too long.
No. This is super helpful, especially for anyone watching, for the students. Someone commented that one thing they notice in your GitHub repository is that the files are missing file types.
Thank you. It's not so so I just created files and then pasted. I've actually never used GitHub before. I started my GitHub repository like a week ago. Thank you for pointing that out. I didn't know that was a thing. I'm a GitHub noob, so thank you. I will fix that.
Gotcha.
Because I just pasted it like in a notepad document or whatever.
This
is the code.
Take
it. Yeah, it makes sense that it's actual files.
Gotcha. Cool. Well, thank you guys for letting us know. Cool. Now let's go into, I think there's one person who submitted their work. So I think this is a great way for you guys to see kind of like, I don't know, like Mark, you can now kind of pick at Marcus's brain of how he sees things. So maybe we can like start this thing. If you want to, there's a sync sketch link in Twitch. So if you want to scrub through, then actually let me send you in case you don't see the link. There you go.
Oh yeah, the sync sketch in the chat and Twitch.
Yeah, if you open that, you should be able to scrub, and I should be able to.
Oh yeah, I see it. I see the same thing.
Yeah. So if you want to play it, and then we can kind of talk about it.
Oh, I love Hajime no Ippo. It's good stuff. Is it okay if I mute? There we go.
Yeah.
Jordan gameplay animator. It's awesome. Where do you get this rig? I want a Hajime no Ippo rig.
I know. Super appealing. So he said he's aiming for a junior or low mid position as a gameplay animator in AAA games.
Mm-hmm.
And they say they apologize for not having any engine stuff yet.
No, that's okay. We gotta start somewhere, you know. Can't do it all at once.
Cool.
Yeah. This rig, I need to try this rig still. It seems really cool.
Yeah.
What kind of feedback are you looking for?
I don't know. He didn't specify, but anything that you want to give tips on or feedback on?
Yeah, I think, first of all, I'm curious kind of where he's at with each animation, and if there's any of them that he specifically would like a lot of feedback on. But I think in general, something that stands out to me about this reel is that it's quite long, and I would probably try to shorten it down a bit and kind of pick the most key components of the reel of what you want to show. Like for me, for example, like it's nice to have a run cycle, and then this punching is pretty nice to keep. And then you have a walk cycle, and then I would probably cut to like maybe this action or something, and then kind of cut it, and then try to focus on polishing up those specific shots. This run cycle specifically is a bit strange out of context. I understand that it's like a charging thing that boxers do a lot. Probably.
Not sure. person.
But I think like when I see a boxer, I would love to see like the punching. That's like the main thing that I would like to see. Shadow boxing can be cool too, to show like some of the weight shifting. But overall, I think like it's the punching that kind of does it for me to show like these action-y bits. And you can get in these like nice weight shifts and show impact and stuff on here without the other stuff. So I'd probably try to focus a lot on the punching action on this character, and then walk and run cycles on this character, and then the last action-y shot on this character. So I don't know if we should pick something to go over in more detail, or
I don't know, is he even in the chat? But I'm not sure, but yeah, maybe we could just, can you pick a punch to go over? Okay.
Let's see a good one. We scrub through a little bit. I think also like showing straight from the back is rarely a good idea. I think it's nicer to show it like a bit more perspective, something like this, or over the shoulder.
Right.
I would probably also try to limit like this kind of crazy type of move. I would leave that out until you've actually like nailed down the fundamental boxing parts. And typically with stuff like this, I think it often comes down to following reference. I'm really curious if you have like a strong reference for this. So if we take this punch, for example, I would probably try to find a strong reference or record reference on your own of something that is really similar, and then try to match it really, really closely. to make sure that you have the bonding mechanics down. Is there any way to crop set range?
Yeah, there you go. And yeah, I think it's just a bracket.
Here. Yep. Like that, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep, you got it.
Yeah. Because I think things that stand out to me with this is that typically, like, a lot of the punching and a lot of the force come from the hip. But in both of these, like, he's mostly moving up and down with the hip. And I would probably like to see, like, a lot more follow through
right
on them, and, like, being more aggressive and go forward a little bit more.
Right.
And I think this is where reference would help a lot, to just see what the body actually does when you try to execute these moves.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Yeah, he said that he used reference for each punch, but took some liberties. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Yeah. He said he'll be interested how you would break down the reference. But something you can go over probably in class in the future.
For sure, yeah, for sure. That, because that's basically where I would start, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And something I'm reacting to too is his the impact his punches seem to be having on this poor pillow is very extreme.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's moving around a lot while he's pretty, like, compact and contained.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of makes it feel like slightly, what's it called, over supernatural, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I think most of this is just core body mechanic stuff. Mm-hmm. So for me, yeah, more movement in the hip. A lot of the body parts feel very floaty and not very, what's it called, grounded. Mm-hmm. Like, it's very, very awkward to stand on your toes like this for a period of time while delivering punches.
Mm, right.
For example. And then, yeah, I see the knee kind of floating a bunch here.
Right.
And then there's also, like, a lot of kind of stop in these poses here before he kind of moves into the next punch.
Right.
So probably kind of cut that on down. Down on that time a little bit.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
His hair is crazy.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Cool. That's it.
But yeah, I'd be really curious to see the reference.
Right, and break it down from there.
Let's see what he wrote. I used reference. Yeah, exactly. I have to push these motions to get them cooler. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. It typically starts with the reference, and then you can kind of take some liberties there.
Mm-hmm.
But I think there are some basic body mechanic stuff here that is missing.
Gotcha. Yeah, I know. Like, that question comes up a lot, I think, in general from students, especially of, like, how to push the reference. Is there something that you do, or tips or tricks of, like, how you see reference, and is there something that you do to, like, I don't know, to basically kind of like what he was saying of, like, having liberties in that, of, like, finding ways to, like, be creative in the sense of, like, choosing, you know, where, like, which areas you can push the spacing or the timing or the posing, but while trying to make sure everything feels grounded in the mechanics of it. So how do you go about that?
It's a very good question. I think I typically, as you could see, like, from how I work with run cycles and stuff like that, I typically work very controlled and kind of work my way out. So typically I like getting, like, a base layer in of some kind. Mm-hmm. And then I start kind of pushing and pulling things and see what works.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like in the run cycle example, like, as when I block out the feet, it's going to be very even and mm-hmm. just fit the speed. And then when I have that, I'm going to start pushing and pulling keyframes and see where can I add those spacing differences. Where does it fit depending on the reference, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's probably how I would break down something like this as well. I would start with trying to having just the base mechanics down and try to match it very closely to the reference. Mm-hmm. And then based on that, if we try, for example, if we take a pose here, like just this pose, right? Like mm-hmm. I would probably look at the reference and see what is this pose in the reference, try to match that as closely as I can.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, try to just push it a little bit further, right? Like mm-hmm. rotate things further, mm-hmm. pull his arm out further, make the feet even wider, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then same thing when it comes to like spacing of things. Like maybe in the reference, it does take 1, 2, 3, 4 for the hit to connect. Mm-hmm. What if it only took 2 in your animation? What if you cut these 2 frames?
Mm-hmm.
And it just went kapow, you know, like stuff like that. You just start like pushing and pulling things and noodling with things, to see what feels better, right? And what's too much.
Gotcha. Cool. Yeah. So, I mean, obviously we can't do like a full review or anything, but yeah, I think that's a good example of like, finding ways to like just maintain the mechanics of everything, but also like finding ways to like kind of put your voice as an artist, I think is like the key to it too.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah,
for sure. And it also depends on the style that you're targeting. I mean, there is nothing wrong with trying to target like realism, right? But if you're trying to push like a very stylized style, then yeah, you obviously have to find like opportunities to kind of push it way further.
Right.
I think also stuff like that, like finding animations in film or games or even other animators' demo reels that have done something similar that you can kind of take inspiration from or find ideas, mm-hmm. that also really, really helps,
mm-hmm.
With stuff like that.
Gotcha.
Because it's sometimes that I'm trying to animate something and I just don't know how to do it. And then I'm like, wait, I think I saw a movie, or like, oh, that one clip in that film I saw, that was really good. Mm-hmm. And then I look at it and it's like frame step through it. It's like, oh, right. Okay. They cut that frame and they hold on that frame. Okay. Let me try that. And then you kind of go from there.
Yeah, for sure.
Like for example, with the Hajime no Ippo, since he's from an anime, like I would probably like study the shit out of what he does in the show.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. I think I definitely learned a lot from stepping through like other artists' work. Like on Vimeo or sometimes even at work, just seeing like some of the choices that they've made, and it's kind of interesting to kind of like just kind of see it from their eyes of like, oh, it's interesting that you would do anticipation here versus there, or like, you know, do like a crazy choice there. So
mm-hmm. yeah, exactly. That's something that I started doing with a lot of Disney films, also played Pixar too for that matter. Like every time there's a trailer,
mm-hmm.
then I end up like cherry picking a couple of scenes, and then I just sit and like frame step through it way more than I'm into the actual film or like the trailer. I'm like, oh, how did they do that like snappy thing, like how did they ease into that?
No. Yeah, for stuff sure like
that. How did they go from that was something that I looked at, I forgot the name of the film, but it's like a new one coming out about each character, like each person has a superpower, and then there's one person that doesn't.
Oh, Encanto. That's what I'm
exactly.
working on. Yeah,
yeah. Oh, cool. That's awesome. Yeah. So it was like a character there that's changed shape, right? Uh-huh, like it mimicked other people.
Yep.
So I was like, how did they hype that? So I just sat there and like each cut of that character, I just frame stepped through it. It was really cool.
Yeah. No, that's awesome. Do you do that within the studio as well? Because I know like at game studio, sometimes you could have like multiple projects going on at once. Like, do you guys like kind of like, I don't know, it's like a, do you guys like get inspired by each other, like in terms of like sharing animations?
Definitely. Yeah, both sharing from external sources, but also jamming with each other, and you know, asking people constantly for feedback.
For
hey
sure.
Look at my screen, can you look at this, can you give me some feedback, do you think this is a good idea, what can I do here? Also things like, for example, we have a couple of animators from Disney on the team, right? Mm-hmm. And they are really good at face stuff, or finding appeal in the face,
right,
of a character. I mostly animated like full body gameplay stuff, so I always turn to them for feedback or for advice for it, and it always helps me a lot.
Yeah.
And it gets me inspired.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah, that's like something I always like tell students, is also like use the resources around you. Like, you know, don't be, because I think like when you start as a especially as a junior, you're so afraid to like, or not afraid, but you like, you want to prove yourself, and that ends up kind of making you like try to like kind of be in your own bubble and not ask for help or not ask for other eyes, just so you can feel like you're doing everything. But then as soon as you step out of the comfort zone and you like get feedback from a bunch of people or asking like leads or, you know, even your peers, and how much that helps and how like how that makes you grow faster too as an artist, I think that's like also very important.
Definitely. I feel like I learn by far the most when I ask for feedback more often.
Yeah.
I usually get very lost if I work on something in silo. Mm-hmm. I also get very, I don't know if bored, lack of a better word.
Sure.
But I start doubting a lot of things. Like, yeah. No, this doesn't work. That doesn't work. Like, what am I doing? But then as soon as I just show someone and ask them, they can either say, yeah, this is good, keep going. Or they can say, oh, maybe we can try this. And it's like, okay, cool. Now I have direction. I have somewhere to go. You know, I'm not stuck in my own head.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Yeah. Because even now I catch myself sometimes as like, I'm just like so like just in my like just zone, and then I just like forget. I'm like, oh yeah, I could ask for feedback, you know. But yeah, cool. Okay, so thank you for providing some of your feedback.
Yeah, thank you for showing. Thank you for sharing.
Yeah.
Whoever it was that shared. Yeah, that was awesome. Good work.
I think he has a question as well. If he was aiming for more stylized gameplay animation, would you be able to mentor me for that?
Definitely.
Something along the lines of DMC.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Love DMC. Genshin Impact is awesome too. Yeah. No, for sure.
Yeah.
I'd be happy to. That'd be exciting.
Yeah. With that said, like, as we kind of close this Q&A, is there something that, like, especially for potential students who wants to sign up and to learn from you, of like, you know, things to expect or like things that you want to share with the students, and I don't know, something that you would love to do in, you know, in the setting of Kyoshi versus like any other place. So yeah, I mean, kind of like floor is yours of like just whatever you want to like say to your potential students.
Oh yeah, I think a big thing for me is I would kind of like to help bring people into a little bit the, how should I say it, break down the technical aspects of making games. And make it a little bit easier to get into that technical mindset of how to build like a locomotion set of a character in a game, and how to think about game actions, right? And how to set up everything up so it works properly in game engines and stuff like that. But also I think a big thing for me throughout the years have been that it's the biggest thing with animation and making games to me is communication and getting everyone on the same path, and making sure that everyone agrees. And making sure that you get a lot of feedback from people to really nail down what you're trying to achieve.
Right.
So if anything, I would just like to be the type of mentor that the students could always reach out to and get mentorship, be it like navigating the industry, navigating tools, navigating how to animate things, getting feedback and things like that. Because animating should be fun, and it can be very collaborative and exciting.
Gotcha.
So I think that's just something that I would like to offer as much as possible.
Yeah, no, that's cool. And I think that's why we're so excited to bring you on board, is because it seems like, you know, because Kyosha is very founded on this idea of prioritizing students' growth, and a lot of that is through feedback and making sure we spend enough time for every section, from the foundation and all the way to polish, so making sure that we're not skipping anything, to make sure that every student has a learning opportunity where they can see the mistakes that they made, you know, like, you know, either that be the spacing or posing that could be improved. But yeah, and I think like your mindset of like wanting to provide as much help as you can for each student, I think that's like what I think rings true for a lot of the people at Kyosha. So yeah, I think we're excited to have you.
Awesome. Yeah, I look forward to it. Yeah, I'm excited to help people and grow together, because I'm going to learn a lot too. Like, I don't think I've ever animated a boxer, for example, so that'll be amazing. Like, I get to study that reference and kind of learn from that, right? And we learn together, because you're never done learning, right? It's always something to improve, and you're never done.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's a never-ending journey. You think you're done after you make it in the industry, but it just just constantly growing.
Other stuff that is really important to me is like fail often and fail early. Mm. This is something that I like in game development, where we just push things into the game editor or game engine as fast as possible to just see, does this work, does this work, does this work, right? Because to me, failing is basically part of the process. Mm-hmm. Like, if you're not failing, you're not learning, right?
Agreed.
And I think it's this, like, I've worked at a lot of studios where people were just like kind of scared of showing things too early.
Mm.
But to me, showing things almost too early and figuring out a lot of the potential flaws of an idea or of a type of execution on something can save you so much headache later.
For sure.
Right?
Yeah.
So basically, yeah, the idea of failing often and not taking things personal and kind of try to grow together and create things together collaboratively is something I really believe in and would like to bring to the students.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that's like something that I also tell students is like, the more time you spend with your work before showing, I think you like grow this this feeling of like this like relationship. You almost create this relationship with like this thing that you've created, this idea that you've made, and the more time you spend with it, more, you know, personal it gets to you. So like when you finally show to either directors or to leads or whatever, and the idea just completely doesn't work, then it makes it more heartbreaking to throw all your hours, the time you spent with that shot, away, or your idea. So like you said, like failing early, I think is so important to make sure that like just the idea alone makes sense. And, you know, like, is there something that could be pushed? Like, could it be more clear, you know? And I think if we get the idea and just the foundation aspect of it, like clear from the beginning, making sure you show early and fail early, like you said, I think definitely goes long ways. So you can save time later. Yeah.
Absolutely. And I think this is something that kind of goes back to, you know, how it's always said that if you're writing something in a notebook, it's always the hardest to like start on the first page. You know, the first blank page is very daunting. But as soon as you like just scribble something and then, okay, you've broken it in, now you can start writing stuff or using the notebook, right? That's kind of how I tend to see on any type of creative work as well. Just get started. Just do something. Just like punch the keyboard. At least you have something, you know. Like, you just get started. It's kind of like I showed in Maya earlier. Like, you just copy one curve to another. Maybe it looks like garbage, but at least you started. At least you can just pull that around until it looks good, right?
For sure.
I think overall, like, just try something. Just get started and have fun trying to find what works.
Yeah, for sure. Awesome. All right. Well, if you guys don't have any more questions, we'll probably end the Q&A here. I thank you, AJ, for posting the schedule. So right now it's set to Monday and Thursday, 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time for your class, correct?
Yeah, okay. That sounds about right.
Yeah. So our enrollment will start in August 9th, but you can apply anytime as long as you have your application in. And then after we review your work and if we feel like you're qualified to be a student at Kyoshio, then, you know, then you'll receive an email when enrollment opens and you'll be able to register. But yes, if you're interested enrolling with Marcus, he'll be our new mentor that's coming on board. So yeah, if you're interested in games and wanting to get into the industry, Marcus will definitely have a lot of tips and, you know, feedback that he can provide to you guys. So hopefully this Q&A was like a snippet of like what you guys can expect. And I feel like even just within this short snippet, we got a lot of like helpful tips and tricks. So I think that's pretty cool. But yeah, cool guys. Thank you for joining.